today's big shot, 9-time Grammy winner Carlos Santana, who's just released The Universal Tone, bringing his life story to light in his first autobiography. It's an inspiring read, chronicling the journey of a poor Mexican boy born to a musician father and strong-willed mother who made his way to America against all odds to become one of the greatest guitar icons of all time. He writes about it all: Woodstock, drugs, seances that inspired supernatural, a new marriage, but above all, transcendence and transformation. Today's big shot, guitar icon Carlos Santana. Welcome Carlos Santana to Big Shots.
Thank you so much.
The iconic Carlos Santana, supernatural, oneness, black magic woman. I can go on and on. A lifetime of music and a lifetime of your stories in your book, Universal Tone. How does it feel to come clean in such a candid way in the written word?
I feel very grateful. It's a book of many stories of miracles and blessings and triumphs. I like focusing on triumph and victory, you know, over whatever gets in front of you in a gracious way.
It's almost like the American dream amplified. You have these very humble roots from Altlan, Mexico, and then you have Tijuana and strip clubs and poverty and a dad who was a musician and a mom who had to raise you and was a fireball herself. How do you think you transcended it all? Was it an inherent spirituality, or do you think you learned along the way how to see the world that way?
Yes, you learn through life to use certain mechanics of grace, like belief, trust, hope. You know, faith is the substance of things not seen. You hold on to those things that transcend time and gravity. In issues and luggage and baggage, and you know, it's a constant everyday. You have to be up to face your fears, and one at a time, touch them, illumine them, and discard them.
Why did you write this book now?
I wrote it because I think it's a good time to invite people to claim their own light. You know, I love this saying. You know, some people give each other high five or, you know, this or that, you know, and they have a certain way of greeting each other. My favorite greeting is, may the heavens open up and the angels bless each and every one with the deep awareness of your own light. That's a real high five, you know, because you're inviting people to claim your divinity, your light, you know, your holiness, your sacredness, you know.
Was it hard being Carlos Santana in a world that doesn't see the spirit and the other realm as you do?
No, it's actually more fun, you know, because most people are going glue, and you're walking on water kind of thing, you know, and running, you know.
What about when they think you're nuts? Is it hurtful?
No, on the contrary, you know, it's a compliment. Everyone that I know has transcended time, whether it's Jesus or Einstein or Hawkins or certain people, you know, Wayne Shorter, Herbie Hancock, you know, they're nuts. They're nuts because they see outside the realm of a temporary reality. In other words, you're crazy enough to say this. Only those who can see the invisible can do the impossible.
Could you always see the invisible when you were growing up in really poor conditions in Mexico?
No. You know, at that time it was just take a deep breath and let it pass. You know, like it'll pass. But I always had next to me trust. Trust is thrust, velocity, spiritual velocity. I don't like crawling for too long. You know, once in a while I will go into this dream that I'm limited or I'm, you know, lonely or I'm this, you know, and sometimes it's very daunting, but most of the times it's very boring. after a while, you go, okay, that's enough of that. Why don't we get into some stuff? You know, let's do some other stuff, you know? It's just important not to stay in one place too long.
So when I read about your early life, there was pain there for a little guy. Dad wasn't around, he was a musician, and your mom was a tough cookie, and yet you still dedicated the book to her. Tell me about, you know, the influences that your mom and dad had on you and how you transcended some of those angry and, you know, hard feelings into love.
Oh, thank you for asking that. I thank my mother for her prayers and her conviction. We both learned, because at that time we didn't have the language that we have now, the tools and skills language, to communicate gentler or more with compassion. But at the same time, she had four sisters and two brothers, and so she had to, you know, grab the reins in the family because dad was absent a lot and for a while. I thank both of them immensely. By six months, they would have been married 60 years. And so, and when I still looked at them, even in the very end, they just look at each other and you know that they're totally, absolutely in love. So all that other stuff was just stuff, you know? And so I learned to see that, wow, that's incredible how they can just look at each other and we all disappear, you know? I learned from them diligence, from my father. He when things got really serious, he would just start cracking up. And I was like,
you write about a scene when your mom just decided, I'm picking up and taking this money that was sent to her, and she's packing the kids in the car, and she went to this house where the address was, and it was a hooker's house, and you all were in the car and outside watching that whole scene. How do you reconcile that as a little boy? Like, how did you reconcile that as a kid?
Well, you learn to accept what Coretta King said, that all men have feet of clay. You know, which means that we're human, we're unvulnerable, but at the same time, you know, we all fall from grace by our own choices or wrong choices, you know. That opens the door for utilizing what Desmond Tutu and Dalai Lama and hopefully the Pope, you know, utilize: compassion, understanding, kindness, you know, patience, you know, more understanding and more compassion, mercy, you know. Those are the really incredible gifts to give to your parents because they did the best with who they are and what they have. That's undeniably so. Most of our parents, you know, there's no manual to being a parent yet.
You also write about being molested as a young boy when you got to Tijuana. Why did you choose to reveal that so publicly?
Everything's healed only in two things, forgiving and in the light. Otherwise, you wear like a badge of honor. How are you? I'm the one that was molested, you know? And you become like, you're not happy unless you're miserable. I take instructions very, very well from my inner voice, and my inner voice says, we give you so much, we give you a lot, many blessings, many miracles, and we ask in return that you share with people something that will be healing to them in mass quantities. Invite people to look in the mirror and say, hi, to yourself. I am not what happened to me. I am still with purity and innocence.
What has the reaction been, and what has been most surprising to you about the revelations in your book?
Overall, I think people are encouraged and inspired. Hopefully, one person at least can change their course of life from self-deception and self-destruction into a place where, like, I can say it now, that skinny Mexican did it. I can do it too.